Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. I'm sorry we're still meeting on Zoom. I thought last time that we had had this wonderful meeting that we would be able to the next time meet again in Tel Aviv, but I guess a force majeure, there's nothing we can do about it. But anyway, we're very happy to see you. This is the 2021 Israeli Democracy Index presentation, and I hope you're all well. As I wrote to you, we are going to be recording this briefing, and it would be wonderful if everybody could leave their cameras open. We could see each other and facial expressions and responses. That would be wonderful. What we're going to do is Yohanan, Professor Tamar Herman, we've had technical issues and I'm not sure that she's going to be on the call with us, but Yohanan Plesner will be presenting the index. And when he finishes presenting, we will open the floor up for questions. And then everybody can just unmute themselves, raise a hand, make a comment so that we can try to have a bit of an informal discussion like we do when we meet in person. So I'm gonna hand the floor over to Yohanan Plesner, the president of the Israel Democracy Institute. And one last thing, when you speak, if you ask a question, if you could please present yourself, your name and what embassy you're from so that we can, we aren't able to do name charts so that we can know who we're talking to. Have a great, I hope we have a great meeting. Yohanan, floor is yours.
Yeah, thank you. So hello everyone, and thanks Danai for the kind introduction. We still hope to have Professor Tamar Herman join us. She's having some issues and we're trying to resolve them right now. But since we've been on a roadshow going to the president together internally within IDI and so on, so I think at the level of a 1 hour discussion plus Q&A, hopefully we can do, or I can do a good enough job. Ora Navi, who's managing with Tamar's instruction, the Viterbi Center for Public Opinion Studies and Policy is here with us as well. And we'll also be able to address some of these issues. So with your permission, we will jump directly into the topic of the discussion. So the Democracy Index, some of you are aware of it, some of you are less aware, is an annual publication of the Israel Democracy Index since 2003. So it's the 19th year, next year will be the 20th year. The Viterbi Center for Public Opinion Studies and Policy has been established in the 50s by a sociologist by the name of Louis Gutman in the Hebrew, and was adopted, moved over to IDI more than 20 years ago. And it's basically the largest database on views of Israelis, Israeli society on an entire array of public, political, recreational issues with all the different ways to slice and dice the data. So I think we have the best barometer for Israeli society. We have publications, monthly publications, which many of you are aware of. There's an annual publication on Jewish-Arab relations, on the Haredi society in Israel, on economic matters. But this by all means is our flagship product of this center, which gauges the views of Israelis on our democracy, on the main issues that the state is facing, on state institutions. And obviously we analyze the data based on the various parameters such as level of religiosity or self-identification is right, left, and center. And I think it gives us a very good view of where Israelis are. So I think an interesting way to start is how do Israelis, what do they think about the, if to borrow an American term, the State of the Union? Since the worst situation in the eyes of Israelis with respect to this question of what's the state of the union was in the, you wouldn't be surprised, in 2003, 2004, during the Second Intifada, around close to 70% of Israelis thought that it was bad. And another more than 20% thought that it was so-so. And only 10% thought that it was good. So this was really a low point, and understandably, you know, buses were blowing up right, left, and center. And for those of you who haven't engaged in discussions before, I think that in many ways, conclusions of the Second Intifada are what has been shaping Israeli politics for the past two decades in terms of the movement of a large chunk of Israelis from the left to the center, and basically the fact that the Palestinian issue was no longer an issue that defined Israeli politics ever since the Second Intifada, because a majority of Israelis were persuaded by those events that there's no real option for negotiated peace. So this is just as a for the sake of comparison, what we've seen over most of those two decades is that a majority of Israelis thought that the state of the country was good, around 50-60% in the past few years until 2019, and another chunk of about 30% thought it was so-so, you know, in the medium. And what happened in the past 2 years, and this is indicative because we've seen that many things have changed in the past 2 years, is that about 15% of Israelis moved from the good bracket to the so-so. So now we have about 45% who think that the state of this country is medium, 31% think that it's good, and 24% think that it's not good or bad. So this is the change that we've seen since 2019 is indicative for many other changes that we've seen. Now, what happened since 2019? Many of us obviously are aware of. There's the COVID pandemic that Israel is facing, but not only Israel is facing the COVID. It's a global pandemic. It increased the sense of alienation of many Israelis, and in particular, young Israelis feel more alienated from state institutions, from politicians, from politics, from the public sphere. And obviously the levels of optimism have accordingly declined. We've seen it also as a decline in the levels of trust in state institutions. So if throughout the past decade, we saw that the levels of trust in what's called the political institutions, i.e. government, Knesset, political parties, and to some extent also the media, the levels of trust were quite low in the anywhere between the teens and the 30s for those four institutions that are basically operating our political system. We saw that traditionally the state institutions that were perceived as more professional, and mainly the IDF and the Supreme Court, enjoyed the trust of a majority of Israelis. And what we've seen are two trends. With respect to the court, there's a sort of gradual decline over the past 20 years, but then a drop over the past couple of years. And the same with the Supreme Court.
Yohanan, could I just interrupt you here just for a second? I just want to say that we're very happy that we've resolved the technical issue and Professor Tamar Herman has joined us. Great. So I just want you to know that. Please
Great.
Continue.
So now I won't have to function as a sociologist. So hello, Tamar, and we will continue. So Tamar will expand on those in this decline of trust. But what we're seeing is that over the past 2 years and the various explanations to that, a decline in trust in the professional institutions, the court, that are very much in the heat of the political debate, obviously as a result mainly of the Netanyahu issue. And there's a dramatic decline. For the first time, only 41% of Israelis trust the Supreme Court. It was close to the 80s, 19 years ago. And over the past few years until 2019, it was in the mid 50s. And now there's a dramatic decline, obviously four election campaigns that had to do, and Israel's probably most charismatic and to some extent, most popular, one of the most popular leaders in its history, and for sure over the past two decades, has been using his power and standing in Israeli public in order to undermine the trust in those institutions, that had an effect. We see that there's a big difference in among right, those who self-identify themselves as right-wing and others with respect to trust in the courts and the legal system. We examined in an entire chapter various aspects that have to do with the perceptions of the Israeli public vis-a-vis the law enforcement and judicial systems, and the numbers are extremely worrying and disconcerting. The Netanyahu factor obviously is an important factor, but it's not the only factor. There are also objective anomalies, difficulties in the functioning of those institutions. And it's also affected by the general decline in trust in professional institutions, in the establishment, and so on. And similarly, we also saw that in the IDF, that traditionally was at around 90% trust within the Jewish population, is now stabilizing at around 80%. Some of it has to do with the general decline, and some of it has to do with a specific decline among the ultra-Orthodox community and among youngsters, which is disconcerting for us in general. I know that it's also disconcerting and worrying for the leaders, in the eyes of the leaders of the IDF. What I thought of emphasizing at this point, where it almost sounds like a cliche, but I'll say it nevertheless, we're at a unique juncture now, because we will know within the next week or two whether Mr. Netanyahu is taking a plea bargain or not. And that will have a serious repercussions for the political system. But if we think about it in a moment, we actually understand that with or without Mr. Netanyahu, the political system will continue to be characterized by instability and uncertainty over the as we look into the foreseeable future. So if Mr. Netanyahu does adopt the plea bargain, obviously there are so many question marks. What will happen within the Likud? What are the processes? Obviously it will make it a lot more difficult for this heterogeneous coalition of 61 that is made up of eight parties from the right, center, left, and the Ram Islamist party to hold together if there isn't the Netanyahu force that sort of is looming out there. But it doesn't mean that this coalition will disintegrate in a moment. There are real political players there with real experience that understand that there's nothing, you know, waiting out there. And the election was just less than a year ago. So there's no reason to go home as well. So, I mean, nothing is automatic. There are various scenarios. Nobody knows what will happen within the Likud. Will Netanyahu remain chairman? How will they elect the new chairman? How will he do, he or she, in the new polls and so on? But for sure, this will mean that we're in a period where the political players are going, where sort of politics will be back in town. If Mr. Netanyahu stays, it doesn't mean that everything will remain stable. First of all, once the genie is out of the bottle of the option of a plea bargain, it doesn't mean that a new attorney general will not offer a deal, or that Netanyahu will not try to initiate a deal. So once the idea of a deal is looming out there, it creates an element of instability. And we see that Mr. Netanyahu also, as he's out of power, as chairman of the opposition, remains an extremely formidable player in Israeli politics. He has 30 plus seats in every poll for the Likud under Netanyahu. He managed to hold on to the alliance with the ultra-Orthodox parties and with the Smotrich National Religious Party. So in any given day, his close allies have around 55 seats, both in the Knesset and in the polls, and they continue, and the same kind of a political crisis that characterized the country during four election campaigns was now imported into the Knesset. That is, now the relationship there is very much characterized by a scorched earth policy of zero legitimacy, zero negotiation, almost zero agreements on issues that in the past were completely uncharacteristic of the way the Knesset conducted itself. That means that there's no state controller committee, there's no an ethics committee, there's no agreement on the allocation of seats for committees, and very few substantive discussions. So this is, you know, the political uncertainty is not over. Even if Netanyahu stays, and even if he leaves, it will take time for the system to redefine itself. I'll end my opening remarks connecting it to how it addresses some of the underlying issues. So there's one big experiment in this government, which is the integration or the inclusion for the first time of an Arab, a party that largely represents the Arab minority, Ram, a party led by Mansour Abbas, a unique leader. And there's a huge question mark, both within the Arab society, as we see in the democracy index. When we look at Israeli Arabs, are you proud of being Israeli? 65% were proud in 2019. Only 28% were proud in 2021. This is after the events on May. So while for the first time there's an Arab party in the coalition, the Jewish-Arab relations are at the tension on Jewish-Arab relations is at a peak, and we measure those tensions. It moved up to about 48% think that this is the most excruciating tension that characterizes Israeli society, and it was much lower before. And Israeli Arabs feel less proud, less connected, and so on. And that's manifested in the kind of criticism that Mr. Abbas is being subject to by the joint list, by very professional and experienced politicians like Ahmad Tibi that are constantly attacking him for legitimizing the Zionist government without bringing sufficient results. So that's from one side. And the other side is obviously many among the Jewish public feel extremely uncomfortable about this situation, that the deciding vote that this government depend on is a vote of an Islamist party. And then it's very easy for talented politicians to make the connection between that and the messy chaos, say in the Negev, with respect to what's happening with the Bedouins there, and to say, well, the fact that it's a mess has to do with the fact that the government has no authority over this population and so on. So those are underlying issues that are very much, rather than this government leading a change that will heal and bring together Jews and Arabs, it might actually backfire within both populations. So this is one issue that, you know, the jury is out, but can evolve. And the index provides interesting indications to how it's evolving. Of course, there's the Haredi politicians that are out of power. This is quite a unique phenomenon. Since 1977, they were in power, except for a few short episodes throughout the period. And that creates, again, a tension. You know, it's within that population, accusations that the government is going against anything that is Jewish, kashrut reform and the other reforms are brought as evidence. So again, this identity-oriented tension that has to do with how Israel strikes the balance between Jewish and democratic. So the index gives us a lot of data on that, but it's also connected to the political developments. And finally, the last issue that is very much an issue that is both discussed in the political system, but but has a resonance in what we see in a sort of Israel's identity politics is the attitude towards the legal system. So there's an entire chapter, Tamar will address it, about what a low point we're at in terms of trust of Israelis in the legal system. And obviously it's a manifestation of the fact that those who support Mr. Netanyahu and very much sympathize with him and adopt his narrative that he's being persecuted by the establishment, by the elites, and very much feel at an emotional level that the persecution that Netanyahu is undergoing is the persecution that they identify with and feel that they have that they went through similar experiences and so on. So there's something very deep about it, but the policy implication is the fact that now this narrative around this professional judicial system that is representing elite power interests that have colluded together in order to remove Mr. Netanyahu is something that is very strong and in many ways defining our politics today. So again, the index provides interesting data. And Danai, I'll end my comments. What haven't I discussed? I haven't discussed defense. You know, the true issues that a government needs to deal with that in a more normal reality would be the issues that would define our politics, attitude towards the Iranian issue, Palestinian issue, dealing with COVID, the economy, the booming house prices and how it affects youngsters. All of those issues are issues that the government is dealing with, but it doesn't seem like they define our politics. I would be interested to hear what Tamar has to say about it, because on the one hand, when we ask Israelis, what do you think the government needs to deal with? So many would say cost of living, but will it affect their political, say, voting patterns? No, if you're identity-wise, if you belong to a Shas group, you will vote for Shas. You think that the government needs to deal with the prices, but even if it does it very well and efficiently, you won't vote for them, and vice versa. So again, we're deeply stuck in a situation of identity politics, and then pro and anti Netanyahu debate is not making it any much easier. Thank you.
Okay, well, many interesting points. We'll get back to them when we open for discussion. Thank you very much, Yohanan Plesner. I'm very happy to welcome Professor Tamar Herman, who is the academic director. I know she needs no introduction, but I will introduce her anyway. She's the academic director of the Viterbi Family Center for Public Opinion and Policy Research. Tamar, are you, you can unmute yourself, and we'll be happy to hear.
Unmute myself already.
Perfect, thank you, and welcome. Glad to see you.
Thank you, Danai. Let me first apologize for joining you a bit late. It's an unfortunate combination of schedule problems and technical problems. And when it rains, it pours, as you know, but fortunately enough, I was able to join you, and I hope to add to the points that Yohanan, when he performed the sociologist. Okay, so I'll try to take it from there and not to repeat some of the things that I intended to say, but he already did it. So first and foremost, I'd like to address the last comment, Yohanan, which you did, about the fact that people do not address issues like security and the real hard stuff, as if from the political point of view. But you have mentioned correctly that they refer to the identity issue first and foremost. And in a way, this should teach us something about the way people think about politics these days, because we embrace in a way the more rational approach, right, to politics. And we say, okay, we should prioritize and security comes first, or maybe economy comes first, but then there are the soft issues. But apparently the soft issues are in many cases more influential than the hardcore, supposedly hardcore issues. And we should learn how to adopt both our measurement techniques, but also our political techniques in order to deal with this change of, I would say, state of mind in very large subsectors of the Israeli public and publics in other places as well. Because if we just focus on the issues that we were taught and we think are the most important and the public prioritize them lower than other issues, then it might be a very problematic situation in which politicians cannot address the issues that really bother the publics and vice versa. And therefore we look at the voting patterns and we think what's wrong there, okay? So I think that we are in a transitional era, politically speaking, in which we should recalibrate our means of shaping policies and measuring it without necessarily maintaining that public opinion is the most important thing. Still, security is very important, economy is very important, but identity is also very important, whereas in the past we didn't address that much importance. So let's, I'll try to share, hopefully the technological problem was solved, so I'll try to share my, okay?
Okay.
So my first slide relates to the question which has been repeated since 2003, actually. And it's a very general question. We have it in international surveys as well. How would you characterize Israel's overall situation? And it's very interesting because until 2019, I had to explain, particularly to those who did not like Netanyahu's government so much, that the share of people saying the situation is good or very good increased, although not in a linear way, but still it increased since 2003 to 2019. And ever since then, we see a decline to the point where we have only one third of the population. We had almost 60%, 50 something percent in 2018. And in 2021, we see only one third, which means that the situation really, really changed. And we should also take it into consideration when we see the responses and the answers to other questions. There was no such a huge increase in the number of those who say bad or very bad, but an increase in the number of those who said south and so. So this is our starting point. Then, we'll move to the question of how proud are you, Yohanan, to be an Israeli? Yohanan already addressed this question. And as you can see, amongst the Jews, the situation is quite stable throughout the years, regardless of the change of government and so on and so forth. Whereas within the Arab interviewees, and we suppose that it's amongst the Arab citizens of Israel, we saw a very, very sharp decrease to the point where we have only a bit more than a quarter saying that they are proud to be an Israeli. And before you ask, we can see that the decline actually can be noticed since 2018. And 2019, let me remind you that this was the year when the nation state law was enacted. Okay, so we cannot attribute it to the law, although we have another research project in which we saw that whereas the Jews think that this law did not have any effect on the real life of the Israeli Arabs, the Arab citizens think differently. They do think that the enactment of the law had a practical impact on their daily life. And we repeated this year another question that was asked in the last 4 years. The democratic system in Israel is in great danger, and we actually wanted to see whether they feel that the situation is actually close to a collapse or something. As you can see, in the Arab sample, there was a large majority saying yes, strongly agree or somewhat agree, whereas amongst the Jews, this was not a majority, and still a significant number do have a sense of danger as far as the democratic system in Israel is concerned. And we split it or segmented it by the political blocks. And if you look at it, you see that the upper line represents the left, or the green line represents the left. But you can see that the left reached its peak in this in these terms in 2020 and in 2021, after, by the way, the government, the new government was in place, there was a significant decrease, both on the left and in the center, and some increase on the right. The interesting thing is that we can see a gradual increase in the number of those on the right who think that the Israeli democratic system is in grave danger. And when we ask them why, and when we ask the left why, we got totally different answers. In other words, for example, the left focused on the situation of the judiciary under the attack of the administration, the government, whereas the left said that the judiciary has become too strong and interferes too much in the policymaking processes. But what I want to emphasize here is the fact that the two sides or the two antithetical political camps cannot even identify the same danger when they say that there is a danger. The total view of the situation or reality check is totally different. And this, of course, makes it very difficult to agree on anything, regardless on who is the prime minister at the time. Now, then we move to a question that we asked several times since 2011. And we asked about the members of Knesset. Do they hard work? Are they doing it? Do a good job? In other words, do they deliver? And these are the numbers of those who disagreed with this statement. And we see a majority in most measurement. Now it is almost up to 70%. Who disagree with the statement that most Knesset members work hard and are doing a good job. I suppose that this question would have gotten quite similar answers in several other liberal democracies as well. This is part of, I would say, the frustration of so many citizens in many countries of the functioning of the representative bodies. But still 70% is amazingly high compared to 56%, almost half or a bit above half only 3 years ago. It's important to see that we are in the worst situation ever since we started to measure, of course, on this issue. Then the trust of the institutions, Jewish and Arab samples. The interesting thing is that although there was a decrease in the number of those who trust the IDF and the Supreme Court, you'll see it in a minute, but still at the bottom, we find this year, as we found in previous years, the government, the Knesset, and the political parties. And this is not unique to Israel. In many other liberal democracies, the political, the elected bodies or the political bodies are at the bottom, whereas the more professional institutions like the army or the police are higher. Still, it is important to see the difference between Jews and Arabs on all regarding almost all institutions, with the exception of the media, a bit about the government. This is October, so the joining of Ram was influential amongst the Arabs. This is the same issue throughout the years. And as you can see, the IDF is always on top, and the political parties are always at the bottom. This doesn't look like social sciences, by the way, because normally we would expect it. This is only the Jewish sample. The Arab sample is more hectic, but still the order is it's more condensed, but it is quite stable. Then what we did was to measure the multi-year average trust in all the eight institutions. And we segmented it by the political bloc. And as you can see, two institutions are most in the most critical situation. The one is the Supreme Court, in which the left has a much higher, almost double level of trust compared to the right, and also the media, because many people think that the media is leaning towards the left. I think that it would change in the upcoming years because the media is much more diversified and less unified than it used to be or thought to be. But the Supreme Court, this is a critical situation, because if on the left there is less than half of the Jewish respondents who are trustful of the Supreme Court, this is a very, very problematic situation, because such an institution cannot belong, quote unquote, only to one political camp. Then we moved to measure the level of tensions between various groups in Israel. And this year we saw a change, which is very indicative of the situation. And we really need to see what will happen next year. Between 2012 and 2020, we saw a gradual increase in the number of those who pointed to the left and right tension as the main tension. And there was a decrease in the number of those who pointed to the Jewish-Arab tension as the main tension. But this year, and this was measured in June, which was immediately after the events of May. We saw that again, the Jewish Arab tension came first. Now, and particularly among the Jews, this was a change, because amongst the Arabs, the Jewish Arab attention was always on top. Now the question is, what will happen next? Whether next year we will be back to the left-right tension, or are we going back to the Jewish-Arab tension being the most visible tension in the eyes of the Israeli public? Now, as Yohanan mentioned, we focused this year on the judiciary, and for the first time, we checked not only the Supreme Court, but other courts as well. And the data is quite upsetting, but I have to say that it was the first time that we measured it, and we have no comparison here. And also we should remember that the judiciary was under a very, very fierce attack by more than a few politicians, mainly almost only of the right. And this probably influenced public opinion on the issue. Still, I suppose that there are some very troubling data here, and I do not feel at ease to attribute it only to the anti-judiciary campaign. I think that the judiciary should also reflect on these data in order to decide what to do, whether to ignore some or to try to fix some of the problems that were detected here. So we asked, are judges in Israel selected based on professional or political considerations? And as you can see, only about quarter say strongly or mainly on political, on professional considerations, whereas the majority saw much political content to the selection process. Okay? And if the political considerations are the most influential, then we would expect the judges to fulfill the political expectations of them. And this, I suppose, is a new phenomena, and it should be looked more closely in the future, but it is a very bad sign. Also, we ask, to what extent do you agree or disagree that the judges treat everyone who appears before them equally? Jews and Arabs, men and women, Mizrahim and Ashkenazim, and again, we have a majority of people who disagree. In other words, they think that the courts do not treat everyone appearing before them equally. And this has to do with intuitive justice. It means that many people think that the courts are acting in a way which is not just. And this, of course, pulled the rug from under the feet of many people in terms of their confidence or trust in the system as a whole. Then we move to the Supreme Court, and we ask whether the Supreme Court intervenes too much in decisions made by the government. And here we see a bit more than half saying strongly agree or somewhat agree. Of course, it had it was strongly correlated with the political positions of our interviewees. We had a significant higher than usual number of those who said don't know, but still the fact that so many, 52% said that they strongly agree with the fact that the court intervenes too much with the work of the government and the ministers, it indicates that there is a problem here. And then there was another question where the courts or the Supreme Court comes better than might have been expected based on what I showed you. This is a repeated question. The Supreme Court should have the power to overturn laws passed by the Knesset if they conflict with democratic principles such as the freedom of expression or equality. And here we see over 50% amongst the Jews and a much higher percentage amongst the Arabs, which think, yes, that the Supreme Court should have the power. In this respect, the Supreme Court did not lose the trust of the majority of the public that they can help in making sure that the laws would be democratic enough. So this is a good sign for the Supreme Court, contrary to what I showed you earlier. Now I will move to only two issues that are problematic as far as the real democratic nature of Israel is concerned. The first one has to do with the increase in the number of those who think that we need to have a strong leader who is not swayed by the Knesset, the media, or public opinion. We had 41% saying yes in response to this question, to a majority of 56% in 2021. But the differences between the political blocs is very, very noticeable and significant. There is a minority on the left, about half in the center, and a clear majority on the right, who are very strongly for a strong leader. By the way, amongst the Arabs, there was also a significant number of those who think that a strong leader is a good thing. And we saw it in previous years as well, both this difference between the political blocs and the support of the Arabs in the strong leader notion.
Tamar, I'd just like to intervene for 1 second and say I have questions piling up, and so I just wanted to remind you.
In a minute.
Okay.
The second question is about Jewish citizens of Israel should have greater rights than non-Jewish citizens, and here we see again an increase since 2018. Now it's about almost half of the Jewish sample and a majority amongst the right. And just in order to see again, amongst the Haredim, it's even a larger share, 3/4. I'll skip now the comparison between Israel and other countries. Maybe we'll have some questions about it. And just in order to leave you with some more optimistic views, we have a large majority of the total sample saying that Israel is a good place to live. So I'll stop here and we'll take questions. Thanks.
Okay, that's wonderful. I invite everybody to unmute yourselves. I suggest that either speak up or raise your hand. I have questions that were sent to me as well, but I'd like to give the opportunity first to speak in your own voices if you'd like. So if there's any questions, please let me know. I'll unmute everybody. Hold on. Okay, in the meantime, I'll start asking the questions that were sent to me. So the first question is, if there's a plea bargain for Mr. Netanyahu, do you think that this would impact trust in the judicial system? And if yes, how? So that's our first question.
Well, we see a majority of Israelis who are uncomfortable and generally tending to oppose a plea bargain from both sides of the aisle, if you will. The ones that think that Mr. Netanyahu was persecuted by the system, want him to or expect him to continue this process and to be able to refute those allegations. And those who think that Mr. Netanyahu has perpetrated those crimes, do not want him to get away with a minimal sort of a bargain that will sort of allow him to get away with something very minimalistic. So there's actually a majority so far in the Israeli public that is against a deal. And to some extent, if a deal would be reached, both sides would have a different narrative. One would have a narrative of the judicial establishment acted in a political manner and removed a very popular leader in an illegitimate manner. And another would have, well, Mr. Netanyahu had to be removed. And here is the fact, he actually pleaded guilty because he knew that otherwise he will go to jail for a very long period and so on. So it will remain an unresolved issue and an open wound. And so even if a plea bargain is agreed upon and approved by the court, and this issue will not end. The only thing that will happen is that over time, since our public discourse and public debate is so packed with issues and subjects and challenges, over time it might erode because new agenda items will override it. Mute.
I'm on mute, sorry. So I have another question. 6 months into the new government, do you think that Ram's participation will change or move the dial in any way in terms of the way that Arab Israelis answer the questions of the index on the various questions? Maybe on some it will, on some it won't. What are your thoughts?
We saw a difference between Arab voters of different parties. So apparently it depends. We saw that the joint list voters responded on various issues very differently than Ram voters and the voters of Zionist, Arab voters of Zionist parties. So we cannot put all the Arab public in the same basket. So I suppose that it also has to do with the achievements that Ram is going to achieve during the life of this government, or at least as long as it is in the government. If they will have significant achievements, then I suppose that we will see more divergence within the Arab samples or the Arab public, if you wish. However, if it will leave the government or will be thrown out of the government, then I suppose that the similarities will increase. And in a way, Ram is playing the role of a very significant national precedent, because for the first time we have an Arab party in such a capacity in the government. So we already crossed a Rubicon. I don't know if the Rubicon, and we will see it in the future as well. Certainly it's a very significant issue, both on the Arab side and the Jewish side. And therefore it may affect the Arab's answer and the Jewish answers to our index questions.
Okay. Another question is regarding the question about a strong leader. The question goes, I understand it can be understood negatively, but can it also be read in a positive manner? Can it be understood that Israelis want their leaders, once elected, not to flip-flop based on the latest poll or media report, but to lead by their convictions?
There is always a way to look at it more positively, but if in the question we included ignore the Knesset, not only public opinion and the media, but the legislative body, then I tend to think that it, and the correlation between the political blocs and the understanding of this question makes me think that it is more negative than positive, and it also goes hand in hand with some other, I would say, populist tendencies within, mainly within the right wing constituencies. So, Yohanan?
Yeah, I would like to compliment. Yeah, generally it's a disconcerting figure, the fact that there's also a growth in this desire to see a strong leader that will be able to disregard the media, the parliament, and so on, it's difficult to interpret it as a positive development. At the same time, I would say it might also be a reflection of the, after 2 years of a political crisis, of a political system that was not able to achieve a decisive outcome. And even after the 4 election campaigns, we have a government with 61 that finds it quite difficult to make rather mundane and trivial decisions. So it might also be a manifestation of this frustration of Israelis from the political system and the fact that it produces undecisive outcomes and unstable governments.
Okay. We're going to wrap up in a few minutes. I have 2 more questions here that I do want to address. One question regarding how Israel appoints justices. So the question is, I know that different countries appoint justices in different ways. Do you think that if Israel would change the way it appoints its judges, this would change? Would it affect the perceptions of the judicial system, or is it just noise?
Yohanan, would you like to go first?
Well, it's true that the system of appointment of judges in Israel is the is actually, you know, we conducted research and we compared it to other countries and so on. It's quite a balanced system that gives voice both to politicians, to the political majority, and also to incumbent judges and representatives of the judicial system. Some would say in order to ensure professionalism and a certain threshold of professionalism, and others would say an elite that keeps multiplying itself and so on. But it's true that at the heart, if you ask some of those who are leading this sort of effort to change the face of the judicial system, if you tell them, okay, if there's only one thing at the end of the day that you can change, they would want to change the way judges are appointed and to politicize it. And we know that this was also part of the package of legislation that Mr. Netanyahu had in mind as he entered those 4 election campaigns. So for sure, a complete politicization of the system of appointment of judges might change public opinion, but it might also change the very nature of the judicial system and affect its levels of professionalism, impartiality, and so on. So I wouldn't say that this ought to be adopted as the remedy for the issue of decline in trust.
Okay, Tamar, would you like to add on that? Or should I move on to my last question?
One sentence that Ayelet Shaked, when she was the Minister of Justice, actually increased the significance of the political views of the Supreme Court judges, but it inculcates to other court as well. So whereas in the past people did not think so much about this correlation between political views and being nominated as a judge, nowadays it seems acceptable in a way. So it changes the entire perception of the issue.
Okay, so one final question. We're going to run a few minutes over time, but this is an important question. In the news, there's so much about the secular religious tensions, and we see that a lot of the answers are also reflected on the ultra-Orthodox secular spectrum. It seems that Israelis, though, don't think that this is a major cause of tension. How do you rectify the discrepancy between the news coverage and the data? That's the first question. And the second question is, considering the demographic changes and growth of the ultra-Orthodox community in Israel, how do you think that this is going to affect future reports and what can be done?
Well, the media sometimes, overemphasize certain conflicts and give some exaggerated image of these issues. So there is a tension, but the tension is mainly between the perceived tension is mainly between the ultra-Orthodox and the ultra-Orthodox parties and the non-ultra-Orthodox parties, be them on the right or on the left. So it is not in general between religious and non-religious people, it's about between the ultra-Orthodox and the others. This was very, very visible during the early stages of Corona, COVID-19, because of the behavior of certain parts of the ultra-Orthodox community, and so on and so forth. But in reality, apparently, Israelis do not see it as so critical. As to the demographic share, we should be very careful not to extrapolate from present birth rate and so on to the future. I think that this is part of kind of a campaign to make us scared of the growing share of the ultra-Orthodox. In the past, it was all about the Arabs and the demographic bomb. So we don't know how modernization is going to affect the ultra-Orthodox community. The fact that many more are now into the labor market and so on and so forth. I don't see high chances that we will see immediate influences of the growth of the ultra-Orthodox community on the overall political scene.
Okay, Yohanan, would you like to add to that and wrap it up for us before we let everybody go?
Okay, so it's a pleasure again to meet everybody, and I hope next time it will be face-to-face. And I would just add that what we've learned over the years is a simple statement. Tell me your level of religiosity and I'll tell you who you are publicly and politically. And this is probably the most powerful parameter that it predicts political views, political behavior, attitudes, and so on. It doesn't mean that it makes the issue of religion and state the most prominent issue. But if you look at people's level of religiosity, it also affects their view on defense, on the judicial system, and so on. So it's a reflection of the fact that we're sort of deeply immersed in identity politics. Not such good news, I think, for the country. Not a good news for a think tank that is very much about developing solutions and measuring their effectiveness. And we end up measuring how deeply immersed we are in identity issues, but it is what it is. So thanks again, and then I back to you. Again, you're on mute.
Unmuting again. Thank you everyone for participating. We're here for questions all the other days of the year. We will be happy to share with you the full Democracy Index once it's finished translation. I've sent out the summary, and we will be sending to each of the embassies a few printed versions. And have a great day. Stay healthy.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.